Well, good morning again. God is so good, and we are glad to be here today. And today our study is going to be on the profound humility of Jesus Christ. I'd like to begin by just simply reading a text, and it's in Luke chapter 2. So could you turn with me to Luke chapter 2 today? And we're going to read verses 1 through 7. Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one to his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, and unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that, while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And I'll read on a little bit also. It says, And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God, and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We certainly would like to have peace and goodwill on this earth, wouldn't we? We certainly need it today. If you want to see the opposite of peace and goodwill toward men, just turn on the news and get the latest on the presidential campaign and see what's going on there. The current presidential campaign is unlike any other that I've ever seen before. It has drawn attention worldwide, at least due in part to one candidate. But this campaign has been, I think, to me at least, a great object lesson in the contrast between the values of the world and the values of heaven, between what the world considers valuable and what heaven deems as valuable. And this is especially appropriate for us to consider today when much of the world is focused on the so-called Advent season. They call this the Advent season, you know, because this is quote-unquote Christmas time, right? I remember yesterday I sent out a couple texts, Happy Papal Holiday, to some people, you know. Because this is not the time that Jesus was born. We know that. According to the Bible, it couldn't have been prophetically. He wouldn't have been born at that season of the year. But as I was thinking about what to preach about today, a text came to my mind, and I was riveted on this text all week. And so the text happens to fit in with the birth of Jesus Christ. But I'm not preaching it today because it happens to be, quote, the Christ Mass week or the Advent season. But I want to ask you a question. If we have an objection to preaching about the birth of Jesus during this particular day or this week of the year, what day or week do we get to preach about it? Is there one day or week that's bad or evil or better than another? In other words, do we allow the negative to influence the positive, you see? And so I'm not doing it. I'm making full disclosure. I'm not doing this in light of the fact this happens to be Christmas season, but I'm doing this and it just happens to be the Christmas season in light of it. Does that make sense? Now, we've been talking about this presidential campaign for just a minute. But on the one hand, we have been witnessing a titanic struggle for the presidency of the United States. And this contest, when you think about it, it requires the candidate to raise not just a few million dollars. When President Carter, Governor Carter was running for the presidency against Gerald Ford in 1976, 39 years ago. At that time, and there still is, a box you could check on your income tax form that you could have so much money go to a presidential campaign fund. And this would help evenly fund the presidential campaigns if the candidates chose to take this money. But then they couldn't accept any other outside money. And that year, Both Ford and Carter accepted those funds, and no one else has ever done it since. But they had basically about $25 million to work with to do the whole campaign. Okay? But today, do you know how much Barack Obama spent to become the President of the United States? $1 billion. Not just $200 million or $300 million. $1 billion went in his campaign when he first became president almost 8 years ago. It takes a lot of money to become President of the United States. But it involves hundreds of people, pollsters, consultants, communication directors, policy advisors, travel agents, and many others. It commands the full-time attention of dozens of newspaper and television reporters. In the political arena, the highest value is power. It's power. How to get it, how to keep it, and how to use it to its maximum effect. And the presidency of the United States is the most powerful office on earth. And so it's no wonder that people will spend so much time, a year just a straight campaigning, besides perhaps years in preparatory work, why they'll spend so much money in effort to become the president of the United States, because it means power. But at the same time, as this battle has been going on, most of the Christian world has been preparing to celebrate the anniversary of a quite different event. An event which concerns not power, but humility. And we have been told, when we want a deep problem to study, let us fix our minds on the most marvelous thing that ever took place in earth or heaven, the incarnation of the Son of God. That's from Ellen White's book, That I May Know Him, page 25. She says it's the most marvelous thing that ever took place in earth or heaven. This event was of little notice at its time. There were no reporters from the Post or the Times there. It didn't make the internet. And aside from a few shepherds and a handful of wise men, nobody paid any attention to the birth of Christ 2,000 years ago. Powerful. Powerful certainly wouldn't be one adjective that we would use to describe either this child or his parents. They had so little influence, so little means, that they couldn't procure a motel room, if you please. Even with this mother being great with child, you know, a pregnant woman, if anything, you know, with a child, a pregnant woman evokes sympathy, a desire to help. You know, how many of us could go down a road and see a young man, big, strong guy, out changing a tire? We wouldn't even think of stopping to help. But what if we saw a pregnant woman out and she's got a flat tire? Every one of us would stop and try to do something to help, right? But here, even this pregnant woman doesn't get a room. And so she had this child in a barn, and she laid him in a manger. And even when they went to make the offering that was made when a child was born like this, they couldn't afford a lamb. They brought the cheapest offering that they could have, and that was two birds, a couple pigeons. But this morning, I would like for us to consider the profound humility of Christ and how that humility can be an example to us as his followers today. And this is especially, I believe, important for us today because we live in an age. We live in an age and a time when humility is not respected. Instead, it is held in contempt. And anyone who tries to exercise humility is scorned as a weakling or a fool. If you don't believe me, just listen to one of the particular candidates whose name I probably don't need to even mention. The role of models of our society, they're not the humble, but they are the selfishly ambitious, the proud and the arrogant, the people that society looks up to today, the sports heroes, the actors, the actresses, the singers, the entertainers. They all tend to have two things in common. One thing, They all have a very high regard for themselves. And secondly, they have a great talent for self-promotion. Have you noticed that? We live in the age of the selfie. There's even websites that you can go and see the selfies of the week. Here, President Obama gets involved with some others in this. Sometimes it seems that every time you turn on the television or open a newspaper, all you see and hear is, look at me, look at me, look at me. This seems to be even true of the most new politicians. And I don't need to give you too many examples. The idea is that I am great and I can make America great again. But let us consider instead the humility of Jesus Christ today, and especially the humility in relationship to the Incarnation. The Apostle Paul, and this is the text that's been on my mind all week, in 2 Corinthians, if we could turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9. Paul says, "For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was what?
Rich.
Yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich." It says Jesus, who was infinitely rich in power, in honor, in glory, he became poor for us. Now, the Greek word that's translated poor in this verse, putohilo, it means to be extremely poor. In fact, it's taken from a word that means beggar. If we turn to Luke chapter 16, verse 20, you remember the story that's in Luke chapter 16? You probably do. "And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at the gate full of sores." And verse 22, "And it came to pass that the beggar died," and so on and so forth. Well, the word that's translated beggar there is just this same word that's translated poor in 2 Corinthians 8, 9, just another form of it. It's from the same word. So when it says Jesus became poor, it's the equivalent of saying he became, as it were, a beggar. Because you think about a beggar. I mean, in the truest sense, a beggar is someone who can do nothing for himself. He's dependent upon others. And that's the way Jesus became. The verb tense here is used to the act of becoming poor in the Incarnation. Or Christ so completely emptied himself that he retained nothing of the riches that were once his. He took upon himself human nature and became subject to the limitations of humanity. The Leonidas says, although Christ had previously possessed very much, he became one who possessed nothing. And he did this for you. And you remember, even in Jesus' teachings, for instance, in John chapter 5, we could read verse 19 there. John chapter 5 and verse 19. Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son of Man can do nothing of himself." You know why? Because, friends, he became poor. He became a beggar. And in verse 30, it says, "I can of my own self again do nothing." In the book Sermons on Talks, book 2, in book 2 of Sermons and Talks, on page 111, we read this. "He," that is Jesus, "became as a helpless babe, bearing the humanity we bear. As the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same." Hebrews 2:14. "He could not come in the form of an angel, for unless he met man as man and testified by his connection with God that divine power was not given to him in a different way to what it will be given to us, he could not be a perfect example to us." It doesn't say Jesus didn't have a connection to have divine power, but it says he didn't have it in any way that we can't have it. And he did this, friends, for us, so that he could be the perfect example for us. Jesus gave up his honor. He gave up his glory. He let go of his position. He relinquished all the riches of heaven in order to become one of us, in order to save us from our sins. He gave up that glory in order to become a human baby, an infant. He didn't even come as an adult. That would be humility enough. That would be humbling enough to come and to begin as a man. But no, he didn't do that. He came as an infant. And I want you to think about some points concerning that. Ponder these ideas. Jesus came as an infant, and he was helpless, as all children are. Just like a beggar is helpless, he has to have help from the outside. Jesus came, he couldn't feed himself. He couldn't change his diaper, and it did get dirty. He couldn't move himself about at first. He's just a child. He is totally dependent upon someone else. He can't communicate. He can't make his needs known. He who had created mankind is now dependent upon creation. The hands which had formed the galaxies, which had put the suns spinning and the planets spinning around them and all the cosmos together, now those hands are just waving in a little manger. And they can't do anything. The mouth that had spoken the universe into existence now simply has babbling and cooing. The sovereign Lord of creation has now become the very picture of weakness, powerlessness, and inability. A little baby. But he didn't come as a royal baby. He didn't come as the son of a king or a wealthy baby, the son of money and privilege. There was, as we would say, no silver spoon in his mouth when he was born. But instead, he was a peasant child, born to poverty, born to want, raised in the most humble of circumstances, not immediately, as it were, surrounded by holy angels and the glory of heaven, but instead surrounded by fallen, sinful humans, and a barn full of all the odors that a barn carries. You know, today we have an institution that history didn't know about a generation or so ago. We have an institution called nursing homes. You ever been to one? You ever seen them? Think about the progression. You know, when you are young, you start off strong and healthy, and then you get older and you hit that zenith of physical prowess, maybe around 25, 26 years old. And then despite all your greatest efforts, everything after that is downhill. And I tell you, I've been running down that hill fast and hard lately. But I remember a brother we had, Brother Hill, some new Brother Hill. And what a strong man he must have been when he was young. He was just a workhorse of a man. But when he got older, things changed. And he got to where he couldn't breathe as well, he couldn't walk as well, he couldn't motivate as well. And after a while, he ended up in a nursing home, and he was like a baby again. He couldn't feed himself, he couldn't bathe himself, he couldn't clean himself. Everything had to be done for him. That is the progression of what life comes to for us in humanity. We end up with a total dependency, and we don't like it. We don't like it at all. We try to do everything we can to avoid. You know, every day I have this physical routine I go through of exercise and trying to eat right and all these things. You know why? I'm trying to keep that old age away as long and far as I can. And I don't know if I'm making any progress or not sometimes. But I don't want to be like that. Do you? I don't think so. And yet Jesus voluntarily took on this kind of complete helplessness, the kind that we fear and dread so much. He did this for us. And he became subject to authority. It's true that Mary and Joseph, I'm sure, were great people as far as people go, but they were imperfect parents. They were sinful people just like we are. But yet Jesus had to subject himself to them. He had to obey them and respect them, even when he knew at times they were wrong. Even when they were acting foolishly or even sinfully. Have you ever had to submit to someone in authority? Someone whom you were convinced was wrong? Or someone who you were convinced was maybe even your inferior? Take Christ as your example. But Christ's humility, friends, didn't end with his birth or his childhood. It continued throughout his whole life, his adult life. Turn with me to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verse 43. I'll read verse 42. Jesus called them to him and saith unto them, ye know that they which are accounted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But now in verse 43, he says, but so shall it not be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister, and whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. Even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus said, I didn't come to be served. I didn't come to be served. I came to serve and to give my life. And in Philippians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul picks up on this theme, starting in verse 2. He says, fulfill ye my joy, that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Well, what one accord, what one mind do you want us to be about, Paul? And he says in verse 3, he says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Because it was this kind of mind that was in Jesus that we're to have. And it was the kind of mind that said, I didn't come to take care of myself. I didn't come to look out for number one. I came to look out for everyone else. In Manuscript Releases, volume 15, on page 25, it says, fill the mind with the great humiliation of Christ, and then contemplate his divine character, his majesty and glory the highest, and his disrobing himself of these and clothing his divinity with humanity. Then we can see a self-denial, a self-sacrifice that was the marvel of angels. The marvel of angels. Just as Jesus humbled himself by becoming a helpless human infant, just as he humbled himself by honoring and obeying his parents, and ultimately, as he humbled himself by dying on the cross for our sins, so we are to humble ourselves in our relationships with each other. In verse 6, continuing, Paul says about Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, the margin says slave, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Beloved, here as a church, and each one of us as we're listening, wherever we're at, if we want to be a part of the body of Christ, every one of us as a part of the body of Christ should be seeking to serve rather than being served. I remember something that Thomas Jefferson said, and as someone of his position and caliber, it was a very interesting statement. He said, I don't ever ask anyone to do something for me I can do for myself. I don't ever ask anyone to do something for me I can do myself. I don't want people to serve me. I want to help others. Of course, Jefferson was quite an interesting individual in a lot of ways. But, you know, we're talking about humility, and so therefore, I think if we are called to this humility, we need to make sure we understand what it is. Is that reasonable? Is that fair? That would be our next logical point that we should look at. Really, just what is humility? Well, first of all, I want to say that humility isn't pretending. Humility isn't pretending. It's not the dress down and frown for Jesus club. Did you get that? It's not the dress down and frown for Jesus club. He doesn't expect us to have to look dirty, and he doesn't expect us to have to frown all the time to be humble. That's not what it's about. You can't just look humble, friends. It's not acting as if you were something less either than you really are. If by God's grace you're a first-class, a first-rate concert pianist and someone compliments you, humility isn't saying, oh, well, I really don't play so well. That's not true. That's lying, in fact. It's not even being polite. Humility means seeing things as they really are and giving God the glory and the credit that He deserves. I found this very interesting in the man who wrote this. Probably has some credentials that would make it worthwhile to read. He said, true humility, this is David Livingston, he said, true humility is not to think low of oneself, but to think rightly, truthfully of oneself. And we'll look at a text concerning that in a minute. A Christian minister once said, I was never of any use until I found out that God did not intend me to be a great man. Isn't that good? He also said, it is possible to be too big for God to use you, but never too small for God to use you. And God had an only son, and he was a missionary physician, a poor, poor imitation of him I am or wish to be. Of course, Livingston, of course, was a doctor, you know. But let's turn to Romans chapter 12. Let's notice the text here. Romans chapter 12 and verse 3. Paul says, for I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. He says that we are to think soberly. And this word in the Greek, it means to think wisely, or of a sound mind. We are to think soberly. We're to think soberly of ourselves. That means we give an honest evaluation of the situation. Humility doesn't mean dancing around saying, I'm the best, on one hand. And on the other hand, it doesn't mean moping around saying, I'm worthless. It means evaluating ourselves with sober judgment, acknowledging our gifts and abilities, but also recognizing that they come from God and they are given to us by God to serve one another. If I say I am nothing and I have nothing, then I'm denying that God gives to every man a gift. But I'm to think soberly. I'm not to think better of myself or better of what I have than what I am, but I'm to use reason. And if God's given me a talent, if God's given me an ability, He wants me to use it. Humility means recognizing that all your gifts and abilities come from God. So our abilities or our achievements are no reason to puff ourselves up or to act as if we deserve to be honored or praised for them. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7, the Apostle Paul states this, for who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it? Another translation says it this way, for who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? You see? We have talents. You have talents and abilities from God. So whatever your ability is, use it. It is a gift from God. And if it's being a first-rate concert pianist, then use it. If it's preaching, use it. If it's just being a great homemaker, use it. But give Him the glory and give Him the honor for it, and don't take a drop of it to yourself. Because, friends, no matter how many hours you've practiced the piano every day, you still could have not done anything without the help of God. And the Bible says that when He returns, He expects His own with interest. Right? So if He gives us a talent, it's right to develop it. It's right to develop it. And we are supposed to develop our talents or whatever He has given us. But it all comes from Him. And true humility, living like Jesus Christ, means above all others, that others are first. Others are first. We read that in Philippians 2 and verse 3. That we esteem others better than ourselves. It means being willing to give up our rights in order to serve others, not grudgingly, but thankfully. In Desire of Ages, page 89, we are told that Jesus did not contend for His rights. Often His work was made unnecessarily severe because He was willing and uncomplaining. Yet He did not fail nor become discouraged. He lived above these difficulties as if in the light of God's countenance. He did not retaliate when roughly used, but bore insult patiently. Oh, this is mine. I have a right to this. These are the words and expressions so often we hear. even among professed Christians. But Jesus didn't contend for his rights, and the reason he didn't was because he esteemed others better than himself. It means, humility means that you consider it a privilege to give up your time, your resources, and energy for your brothers or sisters in Christ. It means that instead of walking around expecting everyone to serve us as if we deserve to be catered to, as if we have a right to have our needs met, instead we treat others as if they deserved to have us serve them. It means that we consider their needs and interests to be more important or as urgent as ours, and maybe even more so. Humility is thought to be reaching down to serve someone inferior. But humility is recognizing that before God, friends, we are all of equal worth. Now, it's true, people have different talents. Not everyone has the same talent. Some people do have more talents than others. But as far as our worth as human beings, friends, no one is inferior to you. We are all equal in the eyes of God, and we are to serve everyone in such way. And so serving one another really isn't just, friends, a duty or an obligation. It is then a privilege. These are the sons and daughters of God, and we are serving Him as we serve them. It's a privilege to serve God's people with the resources and the abilities that God gives to us, and that's the reason He gives them to us, so that we can use them in such a way. Now let me just insert a note here before we finish. There's a difference between serving out of duty and obligation, and serving out of love and loyalty and humility. If you're just serving out of duty, you're serving at your convenience. You make yourself available according to your schedule. But if you're serving out of humility, then you serve at the other person's convenience according to their need. Maybe it's not convenient for me right now to go down to the nursing home and visit someone because I got so much to do. But you know what? That person in the nursing home, they can't change their schedule. You have to come to them. You have to meet them where they're at when they're there. And that's just the way it is, and that's what He does for us. And finally, friends, humility means accepting God's love and forgiveness as a gift of grace. It means recognizing that there is nothing that we can do to earn or deserve God's love. All we can do is to receive it as a free gift, the very thing that it is. We can never repay God. And you know what? He doesn't want us to try. Think about that. We can't pay Him back. We never could pay Him back. But He appreciates our service. He appreciates our loyalty. He wants most of all our love. I think once we truly understand God's grace, friends, once we've humbled ourselves to accept His gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, then we are better able to freely give to one another and to make that blessing of the gift of God's grace something that we share with others. And I think that's the ultimate lesson that we learn from the humility of Christ. That by allowing this to become the principle of our lives, we partake of the divine nature. And isn't that what we want? To partake of the divine nature? Amen. To become like Christ in character, to become like our Father in character. And their character is one of service and love. I mean, think about God. He could have so easily, when Lucifer rebelled, or even later when this earth rebelled, from the standpoint of omnipotence, he could have easily wiped every sinner out. He could have easily reprogrammed the minds of the angels to have never remembered any of it. To, as it were, to start back the clock of time in their minds to a certain point and then erase all their memories of Lucifer and start all over again. You don't think God could have done that? Wouldn't have been hard. He could have done that. But it wouldn't have been consistent with His character of love. And so He did it the hard way. At the cross, He gave His only begotten Son to die for us. At the cross, He showed that He was willing to serve. Because remember, this was one of the great charges that Satan had made against God. That God wants all the power, God wants all the prestige, God wants all the accolades, but he won't serve himself. He wants everyone to serve him, but he doesn't serve himself. And God says, now I'm going to show you. I will serve humanity at the greatest cost to myself that possibly can be. I will give my son to die. And Jesus showed us how much he was willing to serve by being willing to die. To die the death of the cross. Where, as Ellen White says, he couldn't see at that point through the portal of the tomb. And he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And if Jesus must die eternally, if he must die for eternally and never, never see the face of his Father again, he will die so that I can have the experience that he had with his Father of personal face-to-face communion. That's what humility is. And that's the demonstration. And that's what God wants in our lives. That kind of humility where we love others so much that we are willing to serve them even if it inconveniences us. And you know what? I don't think there's ever been a soul one that didn't cause someone some inconvenience. It's the way it is. Souls aren't won in an easy way, friends. It's through inconvenience. But by doing that, we help that soul, and we ourselves are watered. We ourselves are brought closer to God and form more of the character of God in Christ than we would ever have if we had no work to do. And so God in his wisdom gives us a great work to do. There's a lot to do, and there's a short time to do it. Short time to finish the work, not only for giving the message, but also for the finishing of our characters. So friends, we need to utilize every advantage we can right now while we have the time. And this is now is the time. And so may that be the lesson that we learn this day. May we apply it. This is a practical lesson. May we apply it into our lives today, starting today.